Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people. A regular podcast on radical, environmental and anti-capitalist politics. Brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Parkin.
Sounds of the Green and Red podcast. I am your co-host, Scott Parkin, in sunny Berkeley, California today. And as always, I'm joined by
Bob Bazanko in Texas. And happy Sunday morning.
Yep. And today we are going to be talking, about a couple of things, but we're going to be talking about this idea of a no-fly zone. So, you know, there's been a lot of talk in the media around and with politicians and generals and things like that, talking about whether the US or NATO should establish a no-fly zone over Ukraine to give some relief to civilian populations, which are under, you know, attack by the Russian military, Russian Air Force, what have you. There's actually a poll that came out late this week from Reuters that said that 74% of Americans support a no-fly zone over Ukraine, with large majorities from both Republicans and Democrats. And so we disagree with this. We decided that we would actually do a little bit of a backgrounder on no-fly zones. And then we're also going to actually just talk about this notion of different weapons that are being used against Russia, things like sanctions and not buying oil and things like that. And we're going to talk about talk about escalation just in general as well.
I have to say, I thought we were going to start an official uniform, so I wore green and red today. So, and fortunately,
I wore my black as always. My black block attire.
Fortunately, this is a topic where saner voices seem to be prevailing. But yeah, I've seen a lot of people talking about no-fly zones and, you know, mostly people on the kind of, 74% of Americans politically. It's funny, of all people, Ted Cruz shot the idea down the other day. But to get to the point, I think most people I'm not sure they really know what exactly a no-fly zone is. It's a very simple concept, and it's actually fairly new. You really started to see the origins kind of come out of the first Gulf War. After the war ended, remember, the United States did not go in and depose Saddam Hussein. They stopped, you know, in southern Iraq. So what they did was establish a no-fly zone. Doing that means you create an area over another country. This has nothing to do with your own airspace, which is, you know, determined by international law. So you create an area in another country, and you say that no hostile aircraft, no aircraft really without your permission, but it obviously pertains to military aircraft, are allowed to be in that zone. So the point was, the United States created this no-fly zone and essentially directed it at the government of Iraq. So it was a no-fly zone in a country, you know, against its own sovereign air rights. And they did that, they said, to protect Kurds and other minorities, and Shia Muslim in the south. So Iraq.
And it was after George H.W. Bush had actually encouraged the people of Iraq, namely the Shia in the south and the Kurds in the north, to rise up against Saddam.
Yeah, I mean, it's really established, like, I think late, maybe even in 1992 or late 1991. And so essentially the United States was telling the Iraqi Air Force it was not allowed to fly in its own airspace. And it was enforced all the way up to the invasion of 2003. And the Iraqis claimed that 1,400 people were killed during bombings in the no-fly zone by the United States. Remember, Bill Clinton more than once, had various campaigns, air campaigns. One was precisely at the time, I believe, of the Lewinsky scandal. So it was not authorized by the United Nations at the time, at the time. Boutros Ghali, who was the Secretary General at the time, said that no-fly zones were illegal. So there's really no standing in international law. They're kind of a creation of the Americans, you know, in that era, kind of done on the fly. It's a show of power. It doesn't have any basis in long-term international law. And you know, you immediately saw it invoked again in Kosovo with Operation Deny Flight.
Well, and also in Bosnia Herzegovina.
Yeah.
Enforced by NATO in the early to mid 90s, 93 to 95.
Yeah. And that time they did go to the UN to get an authorization for it. And it was called Operation Deny Flight for obvious reasons. And I think it included countries other than the US, where they flew from air bases outside. It was a kind of a NATO operation more than that. And I did have the data here, and I can't find it on how many planes were shot down and how many people were killed, but it was effective, obviously. But, you know, keep in mind too that the two countries this is directed against were badly weakened by war, so it was effective. But again, in the case of Bosnia and Herzegovina, it was sanctioned by the UN, not in the case of Iraq. But it's kind of like an occupation of the skies, which has serious repercussions in international law.
And the thing to note about Operation Deny Flight is that there was a sort of highlight moment, or like a big media moment, was that Captain Scott O'Grady, who I think later became like a big spokesperson for the right, actually got shot down by the Serbs, spent 6 days in survival mode until he was able to be rescued. And his shooting down was actually a part of them trying to enforce a no-fly zone over Bosnia. And so yes, just for folks who may remember that episode.
And I mean, I think that's the important point here, because people tend to be cavalier about it. Oh, of course, you know, don't let them fly, you know. And there's the idea behind this, obviously, would be that NATO, in this particular case right now, NATO would create a no-fly zone so that the Russians would not be allowed to fly, you know, would not, you know, wouldn't be allowed. They would be subject to NATO counterattack if they entered Ukraine airspace. And I think people who are cavalier about it don't realize that you're going to have a lot of Scott O'Grady's if that happens. And that's the real issue here. And, at, you know, in a minute, we'll get to the saner heads prevailing on this issue. But yeah, I mean, this is really a hostile act. It's an aggressive act, and it will be met with countermeasures. And, you know, the Russians have their own aircraft and their own missiles. So it's not like you can just, you know, create a cordon and say no one's going to come in here and everything is done. You know, that's not going to happen. This is in Iraq in 1992, which is just, you know, was just devastated by a war. I mean, there have been pretty much every time there's some kind of conflict, now the issue of a no-fly zone comes up. I think, you know, the one that I remember the most, most recently, has been in Syria. And I talk about that mostly because it's a great example of NATO liberals. This is one of Hillary Clinton's, Hillary Clinton was hawkish in so many ways. And remember, in the 2016 campaign, Trump ran attacking her for her hawkishness. And I think Syria, he really kind of bashed her pretty good on that one. She wanted to establish a no-fly zone in Syria, remember, because Syria at the time, the government was attacking people. The Russians were attacking through the air. The U.S. had flights coming out of there. So Hillary Clinton wanted to establish a no-fly zone against Syrian and then also Russian air power. And again, this also points to the U.S.-Russian hostilities. They're not new, and they're not confined to Ukraine or to Georgia or even to that region. In Syria, most people who were dying weren't being killed from air attack anyway. And so Clinton's kind of idea that she could protect civilian populations was misguided from the first. And as soon as she announced that no-fly zones, I think, most analysts and retired military people who were on CNN and, you know, pretty much anybody said this is a bad idea. But my favorite, which I will let you deliver, was Donald Trump's evaluation of that.
Yeah, he basically said that Clinton was just nutty for wanting to impose a no-fly zone over Syria. He said that would get us into World War III with the Russians.
And of course, you know, to say you don't want to go to World War III against the Russians makes you a Russian dupe, I guess. But in this particular case, and I'm not going to defend Donald Trump, you know, I think you all know how we all feel about him. But Clinton, yeah, luckily was rebuked. But that remains in the arsenal. It really sounds good from a media perspective, right? And I think the fact that 74% of Americans support this also talks to the kind of idea of propaganda that we mentioned the other day. You know, when this began, most Americans, I think it was only like 26%, said, yeah, we have a vested interest here. We have to do something about it. And now those numbers are through the roof. And Biden, if the mayor's poll is legit, you know, got like an 8-point bounce off the State of the Union address when he went on kind of full Cold War mode. Biden is now channeling Reagan, I guess. You know, who knows? He's somebody different every week, right?
Or maybe JFK.
Yeah. Speaking of which, check out the Green and Red Medium page. I have an article up about Kennedy and Oliver Stone. You know, I'm like a Rottweiler. I won't let it go. So, amid this international crisis, people kind of tend to rally. And I mean, Putin is really a good foil because he is like a reprehensible kind of, you know, despicable, horrible person who has committed an act of aggression. But at least in this particular case, people in DC who seem to be, you know better, luckily have kind of, you know, smacked this idea down, including Biden. But most recently, just in the last couple of days, Blinken, the Secretary of State, Tony Blinken, and then today, you just a minute ago sent me an article about an op-ed written by Mark Milley.
Yeah, It was from yesterday.
I missed it. Yeah. And Milley, although the right hates him because he apparently was part of the deep state against Trump, but really does have, significant credibility, I think, in those circles. So.
And then it's, worth noting, you had mentioned Cruz, but also Marco Rubio and former UN Ambassador Nikki Haley have both basically come out and said that a no-fly zone would essentially start World War III.
Yeah, you know, that's funny. They keep talking about World War. And I mean, that's a common refrain and it's a nice trope to use. But, World War II, Hitler was trying to take over first all of Central Europe and then all over the world. And then, the Japanese were trying to take all over East Asia. I mean, right now, there's only two states in that region which are not aligned. And that's Belarus and Ukraine actually is, but it's Belarus really. So you really can't start a world war against one country. So I think people need to tap the brakes and not, take a Xanax or have a glass of wine or something like that. I mean, you can certainly see a
hot yoga. Go do some hot yoga.
Do some hot yoga and have a what did Jen Psaki say? A hot yoga and a margarita.
And a margarita. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, there you go. But Ukraine is in the crosshairs, absolutely. And I'm horrified at what I've already seen, the images of what I've seen, what could happen there. But what's the war going to expand to? I mean, Russia's going to attack Western Europe. I mean, it's limited just by the fact, geopolitical fact, it's not really going to expand. Russia doesn't have allies. Bolsonaro, I think, has been kind of supportive, but it's not spreading beyond Ukraine, right? The Russians aren't going to throw ICBMs at the United States or anything like that. So, I think all the support we can muster for the people of Ukraine and the people of Russia, you can't leave that out, is important. But also, I think we do need to kind of have be a little bit more sober about this, because it's not World War III. It's not World War III's world war. I mean, the whole world is at war. Right now it's Russia, with maybe Belarus and some Chechen, maniacs, but it's not a threat to the interests of the United States.
No.
And in fact, it's funny today. I mean, we talk about global interest and economic interest. I mean, the United States is still not just the US. Russia is still getting $700 million a day in oil sales. So again, the gravity of the situation is real and it's legitimate, but you don't have world wars with countries. I mean, even, the United States finally cut off oil sales to Japan in the fall of 1941. So at some point, it gets more serious and we're not at that point yet,
on this topic of escalation. So, no-fly zone is a potential escalation zone. But then Putin also has come out and said that, he considers the economic sanctions against his country an act of war. They've essentially passed a law in Russia that anyone who goes against the Russian state narrative is spreading fake news and get 15 years in jail, which has led to like CNN and Canadian broadcasting companies and other media outlets to withdraw from Russia. but also, you know, 80% of Americans said that the U.S. should stop buying Russian oil. And, you know, we're hoping, we kind of have in the works to do an episode on like fossil fuels and the struggle in the Ukraine. But I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on this idea of this escalation from these, you know, non-military, I guess you would call it, aggression against Russia.
Yeah, I mean, as we know, we've talked about that. We've done shows on Iran and Cuba, who are, along with Venezuela, the targets of the biggest sanctions the U.S. has ever imposed. And they do immense damage to the working people of those societies, but they don't change states. Even, you know, if you look at South Africa, which was kind of a more complex situation, and in general, sanctions, there are people on the left are opposed to sanctions, although not in South Africa. And again, I think most of us are supportive of the BDS movement. But the reality is sanctions generally work against people in less developed countries and poorer countries since they're targeted. And that's clearly the case in Russia. I mean, the Russian banking system has basically been shut down. Russians can't get to their money. The ruble is basically collapsed. I read a little vignette the other day, Russian students in the U.S. can't get to their money, right? So clearly it's an aggressive act. And I mean, you always hear that rhetoric, this is an act of war. But I mean, politicians say that about a lot of different things. In terms of affecting Russia's ability to fight, to cause destruction in Ukraine, it's probably not going to stop them, you know. I mean, clearly, Putin, even if he misjudged the severity of the sanctions or how quickly they'd be imposed, knew something was coming. And, you know, getting inside Putin's head, I mean, I know everybody's writing about that. I don't know what his motives were, but, you know, clearly he knew they were coming. So,
I think they're probably planning for it for years. That would be the response.
Yeah. I mean, it's clearly doing harm. And most of those oil sales, by the way, are going to Europe, not to the United States. Europe is really, you know, in the crosshairs, but they're at risk with regard to oil sales. You know, the United States is mostly self-sufficient in oil production. So I suspect in the U.S. for sure, a lot of these price hikes in gas are kind of gouging. I doubt they're based on market forces or anything like that. Didn't Biden also just release like 60 million barrels or something like that from that?
Yeah. And the Europeans are doing a similar thing.
Yeah, so I think
from the strategic reserve.
Yeah, a lot of this is panic buying. It's commodity speculation. It's like same with wheat, right? Now wheat's probably more legitimate because Ukraine does and Russia both are significant wheat suppliers, probably combined. I forget what percentage of the global market.
Yeah. I think like a third of the global market of wheat comes from Russia.
Yeah,
it's a huge number.
Right. And so I'd say that was a bigger, and it, with regard to pricing is probably a bigger threat. You're going to see more inflation. And, you know, when inflation kind of begets itself, so you start to see, you know, it's basically just gouging. We're seeing that right now. You know, there were some supply chain issues, but everyone is using that as an excuse. Look at what Jeff Bezos is doing right now. Right? He's increased the cost of Prime by $20, which is $4 billion, you know, for all his customers. So, you know, you're going to hear a lot about how the war in Ukraine is causing inflation, and it will. But that's also going to be a large component that's going to be price gouging. But yeah, sanctions, I mean, they're a hostile act, but they're not going to affect Putin and the oligarchs. I mean, they may lose $1 billion, but, you know, there are rumors all over the place that Putin has like $100 billion hidden in various accounts all over the place. And the U.S. is, you know, moving to freeze assets, but that's also difficult to get at. And, you know, the way the international banking system works, you can always hide money. They're seizing yachts, which is a great idea. I just hope they don't take mine. You know, as long as they seize Russian oligarch yachts, that's fine. You leave my yacht alone, you know, but
anyway. Hopefully they won't mistake, you know, a Russian oligarch's yacht for yours. Docked there in Italy. I mean, it's about the same size.
You know, I obviously know nothing of the world of yachts, but how does a yacht cost $800 million? Like, I have no clue what's in a yacht, but I mean, that's like freaking nuclear subs. I mean, you know, like the Pentagon pays for its craft. So, but yeah, they're going to do all that kind of stuff. So the oligarchs will take a hit, but you know, when you have 40 or 100 billion or whatever, I'm not sure losing a yacht is going to break you. It's interesting. You know, I think the key issue here because you did see, shit, I forgot the name now, the second biggest oil company in Russia has told Putin that he needs to negotiate. So that, I think that's the interesting point, because, you know, that's something you and I talk about all the time, is kind of the ruling classes. And, you know, Russia has a ruling class. I mean, Putin by himself does not wield total power. Nobody has 100% of power. Nobody is 100% responsible for things that go wrong, unless you talk to my exes, right? Bada bing. Anyway.
It should also be noted for folks, is that, you know, when we're talking about war profiteering and when we're talking about people making money from this, we're talking about price gouging and things like that, the people who are going to stand the benefit are maybe probably at some level Russian oligarchs, but who knows? It's the American oligarch class. And that is like, that, you know, they made trillions extra through the pandemic. And now as we're moving into, you know, this conflict, as this conflict in Europe is happening, you know, oil companies are getting richer. Shell has actually kind of gone back and said that it will actually buy Russian oil, but they'll donate some of the money to, you know, Ukrainian refugees. But you know, the Bezos of the world and the Zuckerbergs and whoever else they're going to come out trying to look patriotic, but they are also going to be making a lot of money from this conflict at some level.
Yeah, I mean, I think
the American oligarchs, the American oligarch class, but everyone's saying that we should call them oligarchs more, and I totally agree. Anyway,
we've been doing that forever. We've been calling them oligarchs for forever, like forever since. Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think the sanctions, especially, I mean, as long as oil isn't sanctioned, then Russia's that. I mean, sanctions are not going to bring Russia down, and they're not going to force Putin, you know, I think.
I'm sure there's many days of his invasion that were paid by the spike in the price of oil from the
absolutely. I mean, and I'm not aware. I mean, I got to go, and I've kind of been avoiding it because this is not a pleasant subject, and the world is already in disarray. And so, studying this, I mean, I'm not concerned about, you know, people who are concerned about World War III. It's clearly a reason to be concerned, and it's a horrible situation. And right now, I think the issue is to try to figure out, you know, the problem with wars is they kind of create their own momentum. So now, you know, it's March of 2022, and your options are way limited in ways that they would not have been, well, let's say 8 years ago, if, you know, Minsk II, one of, you know, the kind of part of Minsk II was kind of creating some kind of means of deciding what was going to happen in those two republics in the Donbass region. Part of Minsk II had to do with the eastward movement of NATO. Putin, you know, you can deny all you want or say he was faking it, but man, I, you know, in the last few weeks, I have been reading about this. I mean, Putin talked about NATO's expansion all the time. He brought it up explicitly all the time. And you had people from the U.S. ruling class, including Henry freaking Kissinger, who I hate invoking, you know, and George Kennan and people before that in the 90s, Robert McNamara, you know, Matlock. I mean, we've talked about a lot of them in the previous three shows we've done on this, who were warning how the eastward expansion of NATO was provocative. And so it's too late to deal with that, right? I mean, and you know, the United States isn't going to suddenly say, okay, well, we will agree never to bring Ukraine into NATO. That ship sailed, right? So now you have fewer and fewer options. You impose these sanctions. You know, they're certainly hurting Russia. They're squeezing Russia, especially the banking system. Perhaps it'll cause the Russian ruling class to schism and create internal opposition to Putin. There seems to be opposition in the streets to this war. And, you know, even if you shut off media nowadays, you know, there's always ways to get stuff to people. There's, you know, I mean, I see BBC starting shortwave radio transmission again. And there's cell phones and there's, you know, a million things. You see these images of Russian soldiers who are captured using cell phones from the Ukrainians to like write to their, you know, text to their mom saying I'm alive.
Or FaceTime with their moms.
Yeah. So, I mean, clearly the Russians are aware of what's going on, even if official media is shut down. I mean, there was some of that literature throughout the Cold War. They're going to know what's going on in Ukraine. It's not that hard to figure out. If a local kid gets killed, they'll know it. I mean, and I think the U.S. goal, you know, per Brzezinski's brag, was to create kind of an Afghanistan type situation. So this thing isn't going to end soon by any means, right? But at the same time, I don't see Ukraine falling and totally. I mean, that's a big country and it's going to have a resistance. You know, it's not a, it's a country which, you know, has a lot of people who don't like Russians. It has a significant right wing, which we're not allowed to talk about because then we'd be pro-Putin apologists, I guess. But this thing is unfortunately nowhere close, I think, to being over. And I don't think you have to be a Pentagon analyst or a CNN or MSNBC, personality to understand that. If you just study this stuff a little bit, know a little bit about it. And one thing I'd like to point out is, and this is a not subtle at all brag about you and I, but, you know, everybody's been talking about this. I've been, you know, catching podcasts and lefty, I'm just talking about the left media. I don't care about the right media. And everybody's an expert on this. And I've been reading stuff from people who I don't think ever knew where Ukraine was, who are now writing with great, you know, great authority about this stuff. And this is something that we've been studying. I've known this about this stuff, you know, it's what I do. This is actually the one area where I have a little bit of knowledge. So yeah, this has been a long-term process. This war is not, it's new. This phase of the war obviously is new. It's just a massive and really dangerous escalation. But, you know, the war has been going on since really 2014. And the crisis has been going on since 1991. And the U.S., you know, in many ways helped create Putin as much as anybody did. They helped create these oligarchs. They helped break up the old Soviet, state industries. The United States provided Yeltsin with billions of dollars of aid, or else he probably wouldn't even been president again. So, and the U.S. created the conditions for Putin and actually supported him. So, you know, there's a lot of options now that are just no longer available just because too much time has passed.
Yeah. And, you know, for folks who like want to know more about that deep background or just listen to this episode first, check out the first episode that we put out on the Ukraine-Russia arc, which is called Deep Background on Ukraine and Russia. Very, very informative for folks about that history, starting in 1991 with the breakup of the Soviet Union and then the waves of privatization and political machinations of the US and NATO to, you know, contain and keep Russia from, you know, being a serious foe like it was during the Cold War.
And then the second one we did actually goes into even more detail about the breakup of the Soviet Union. And then the third one was a lot of fun, which is more just kind of a background around what the military industrial complex really is. And that's more kind of US centric. And we'll just keep doing these, you know, it's like, you know, this one is fairly brief, but just as things come up, you know, a lot of people are just doing kind of daily blow by blows and, you know, don't want to do that. But when Scott, you know, pointed out, showed me that poll that, you know, 74% of Americans want to establish a no-fly zone. You know, we thought, well, let's talk a little bit about that because that's a really bad idea. But like I said, fortunately, I don't think that's anywhere near happening. Everybody realizes. And, you know, there's kind of a, you know, old phrase, graduated escalation. And you know, I mean, the war is clearly still moving. I'm not sure what to believe of battlefield accounts of, you know, I think Russia will, you know, has the ability to create immense destruction and death in Ukraine. But in terms of taking over that whole country and establishing a puppet government, you know, maybe, but I don't think it's imminent. You know, I think, you know, our point all along has been that they need to negotiate somehow.
The other thing that's going to like really slow it down and impact it, which we're seeing, is just the large amount of arms being shipped into Ukraine from Western countries. Like, it's a really, really important thing to understand there. And even if Russia takes Kyiv and gets Zelensky, whatever, the U.S. is still going to, is the U.S. and NATO and Western countries are still going to be supporting the military that remains, and then whatever insurgency might come after that. It's going to be just a long, we're looking at a long, bloody process going on.
Yeah. Ukraine is not going to be short of arms. In fact, remember a few days ago with that, the image of that like 40-mile Russian convoy, and I'm like, they're in a high, I mean, you know, I'm actually technically, I'm kind of a military historian, which is not
historian, no, not hysterian,
maybe both, but you know, I'm like, when there's a 40-mile convoy on a highway, you know, with woods on either side, I'm like, you know, that's kind of easy. And it has, it's been bogged down, you know, that doesn't take a lot. There's a lot of ways to stop that. And so clearly the Ukrainians are armed and they do have the ability. They're getting Stinger missiles now. They will have adequate weaponry. So yeah, it's gonna be a long bloody war. And Putin, I mean, at some point, you know, maybe somebody in Putin's inner circle will start to say, hey, look, we miscalculated. you know, the key point here is not to to defend the Russians at all. It's to try to prevent more death among just basic young, everybody, young men and women in both Ukraine and then Russian soldiers, as well as the way that sanctions will harm basic, you know, the average Russian people. And negotiation will be the way to do that. And, you know, you're not going to negotiate after what hasn't even been 2 weeks. You know, you're not going to negotiate that soon. Apparently they're supposed to be talking, but I can't see anything really coming of that. I mean, Putin's kind of, you know, in the U.S., one big issue that we talk about, especially with regard to like Vietnam, which I study, is credibility. You know, and your credibility is your is the way that your friends rely on you and your enemies fear you. And so credibility has to be earned in many ways by taking hits. There's a great memo by a guy who was Assistant Secretary of Defense for International Security Affairs, John McNaughton, in 1964, very early in the war. He said, this thing isn't going to turn out well, but we have to stay in. And we have to let our allies see that we got bloody and we took hits. We have to let our enemies know that they'll suffer if they stay in this war. And unfortunately, you know, that actually, I think, is still very much true. And I suspect Putin is kind of looking at it the same way, too. He can't get out now. You know, I don't know about what's inside his brain. Everybody's doing like, you know, everybody's Freud. But I don't know what the motivation is. I mean, there's a long term motivation, right, with regard to this fear of NATO and Western encirclement. I don't know beyond that. Yeah. But I just, you know, let's hope that, you know, I just hope the fewest amount of fewest destruction is done, less destruction and fewest amount of people are killed. But yeah, they got to negotiate, but a no-fly zone would be utterly just catastrophic. It would draw the U.S. into the war, draw NATO into the war in a far more direct way. And I mean, be clear on this, no matter what Russia's military capability is, it is nothing close. The United States spends, I think, the U.S. military budget is like six times that of Russia. And the U.S. is part of an alliance system with 30 other countries in Europe, NATO. Russia has nothing like that. Russia does not have that. China, which is really, I think we need to do a show on that because that's really interesting, because the Chinese have just kind of stayed out. And I think people expected a lot of folks expected China to support Russia. And why would they? You know, they can let the U.S. and Russia beat each other up and, you know, kind of, you know, I mean, one, but I'd argue the main reason China's economic ascendancy in the last 25, 30 years is it just hasn't had any wars, you know, and it does have a much bigger military, but even the Chinese military is nothing compared to the U.S. The United States has 800 bases all over the world. It spends officially $800 billion a year is the defense budget. So it's the Russians are not a military threat to Western interest in that regard. And I think the big fear is obviously nuclear weapons. And, you know, normally under these circumstances, I'd say, oh, no one's going to do that, but you never know. So.
Yep. You have been listening to the Green and Red podcast. We're here for you folks. We really like bringing you these backgrounds and these conversations about things that maybe aren't being discussed in other media sectors or outlets. And definitely, we see ourselves very much as not people who have just kind of come into this whole analysis on U.S.-Russian foreign policy in the last 2 weeks. And because we have a big Twitter account with influencers, which we don't, but you should follow us on Twitter. But this is like an important conversation, and we're hoping people are getting a lot out of what we've been talking about with the Ukraine and the history and the other politics surrounding it, the economics, et cetera. If you like what you hear, and check us out on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. If you're watching this on YouTube, hit that subscribe button. And if you want to make a donation, go to greenandredpodcast.org and hit the support button, or go to our Patreon page and become a patron at patreon.com/greenandredpodcast. And it's been great talking, and we'll have